Penguin Random House Audio presents Blitzscaling, the lightning-fast path to building massively valuable businesses, by Reid Hoffman and Chris Yeh. Read by Chris Yeh. Introduction read by Reid Hoffman.
Foreword by Bill Gates. I've known Reid Hoffman for years. Our friendship started on my visits to Silicon Valley to meet with Greylock Partners, the venture capital firm where Reid is a partner, so I could learn about the companies they were investing in. I was always impressed by his sharp mind and brilliant business sense. Reid is famous for hosting long dinners where the conversation runs late into the night, and we've spent many meals breaking down the technology industry, analyzing the promise of artificial intelligence, and more. When Microsoft CEO Satya Nadella started talking about acquiring LinkedIn, I knew it would be an amazing fit. Of all the things I've discussed with Reid, the most thought-provoking might be blitzscaling. It is an idea that applies to many different industries, as he and Chris explain in the last section of this book. But prioritizing speed over efficiency, even in the face of uncertainty, is especially important when your business model depends on having lots of members and getting feedback from them. If you get in early and start getting that feedback and your competitors don't, then you're on the path to success. In any business where scale matters, getting in early and doing it fast can make the difference. This is especially true for two-sided business models where you have two user groups that create positive network effects for each other. For example, LinkedIn wants to attract people who are looking for work as well as employers who want to hire them. Airbnb wants guests looking for a place to stay as well as hosts with space to rent. Uber wants to attract drivers as well as riders. And a software company with an operating system to sell wants app developers as well as end users. Microsoft definitely went through a blitzscaling phase, although we didn't call it that at the time. We got on the learning curve early and were able to build a reputation as a serious company. We had an extreme culture of working hard and getting things done fast. The ideas behind blitzscaling aren't just for startups and scale-ups. They're important for big established companies too. The window for action can be tiny, and it can close quickly. Even a few months' hesitation can mean the difference between leading and chasing. Reid and Chris's ideas are more practical than ever because it is now possible to get big fast in a way that simply wasn't feasible a few decades ago. There is a rich ecosystem of service providers and outsourcing companies to support rapid growth. Many companies have gone through their own big growth spurts, so there are lots of examples to learn from. User feedback comes in a constant stream of data. Product cycles have dropped from yearly to weekly or daily. And good reviews can spread in an instant online, so a strong product can quickly attract a big audience. In other words, the case studies you're about to explore and the tools you're about to gain have never been more relevant. This is an ideal moment to be listening to this book. I'm glad Reid and Chris are sharing their insights.
Introduction. 2011, San Francisco, Airbnb headquarters. They're probably going to kill you. The year was 2011, and in the offices of Airbnb, then a scrappy little 40-person startup, its co-founder and CEO, Brian Chesky, had just received some very bad news. Brian pondered the implications of the ominous prediction he'd just heard from Andrew Mason, the co-founder and CEO of Groupon. He didn't like it. Brian and his co-founders, Joe Gebbia and Nathan Blacharczyk, had already fought their way through plenty of obstacles to build Airbnb, a website that makes it easy for people to rent out their rooms or homes for the night. In the beginning, every investor the founders approached had turned them down, or worse, ignored them. The company was on the upswing now, but the painful early days were still fresh in their minds, and they weren't looking for another battle. When the Airbnb founders first met, Paul Graham, the highly regarded founder of the startup accelerator, Y Combinator, or YC, told them flat out that their idea was terrible. "People are actually doing this?" he incredulously asked. When Brian told him yes, people were, in fact, renting out their living spaces for a night, Graham's response was, "What's wrong with them?" Still, Graham had accepted the Airbnb guys into a three-month-long YC program. Not because he was inspired by their Airbnb business or because he was impressed by the hustle of the founders. He loved the now famous story about how Chesky and his co-founders managed to pay the bills while trying to get Airbnb off the ground. It was 2008, a U.S. presidential election year, so they created and sold special edition cereals called Obama-O's and Cap'n McCain's, a sugary parody of, or tribute to, depending on how you look at it, that year's candidates Barack Obama and John McCain. The creativity and persistence displayed by the Airbnb founders as serial entrepreneurs got them in the door at YC. Once in the program, they refined their business and were able to persuade two leading venture capital firms, Sequoia Capital and Greylock Partners, where I'm a general partner, to invest. Now, nearly 4 years later, it seemed like all the hard work was finally starting to pay off. Having celebrated its millionth booking, Airbnb had plenty of working capital, and it was clear that the concept was valuable. But when you're successful, you attract competition, and sometimes that competition represents a deadly threat. In Airbnb's case, that threat was three brothers from Cologne, Germany: Oliver, Mark, and Alexander Samwer. They had become billionaires by analyzing successful U.S. companies, rapidly creating copycats in Europe, and in many cases, selling those cloned companies to their original American inspirations. In other cases, the Samwers actually held onto and built out their clones. Zalando, the Zappos of Europe, has over 10,000 employees and was worth more than $10 billion in 2017. Their first success was Zalando, an eBay knockoff they were able to sell to eBay for $43 million, just 100 days after launching it. The Samwer brothers then invested in the German versions of YouTube as My Video, Twitter as Fraser, and Facebook as StudiVZ, before founding their own startup studio, Rocket Internet. In early 2011, Brian and his team started noticing that Airbnb users were being spammed by a new company called Wimdu. Wimdu had apparently just received $90 million, the largest investment in a European startup to date, from none other than Rocket Internet and Kinnevik, a major Swedish investment company that had partnered with the Samwer brothers. The problem? Wimdu's business model and website looked like a knockoff of Airbnb's. Wimdu was founded in March 2011, and within weeks, the Berlin-based company had hired a staggering 400 employees and opened 20 offices across Europe. Meanwhile, the original, but much smaller, Airbnb had only raised $7 million, had just 40 employees, and operated out of a single office in San Francisco. As a first-time CEO, Brian wasn't even sure what was involved in opening a second office, let alone dozens more on another continent. Brian also knew that if Wimdu was able to capture and dominate the European market, Airbnb might not survive. "If you're a travel site and you don't cover Europe, you're dead," he told us in 2015 when he visited the technology-enabled blitzscaling class we taught at Stanford University. The Samwer brothers had named their price. Airbnb could have Wimdu in exchange for a 25% stake in Airbnb. Now, Brian faced a difficult decision with painful consequences, regardless of what option he chose. In response, Brian turned to one of his favorite decision-making techniques, reaching out to the world's leading experts. His first call was to the CEO of Groupon at the time, Andrew Mason. The leading daily deals company had had a similar experience the previous year. In December 2009, the Samwer brothers had just launched CityDeal, their Groupon lookalike. 6 months later, Groupon paid a nine-figure price, roughly 10% of its valuation at that point, to acquire this competitor. Here was the question weighing heavily on Brian and his team: should Airbnb follow Groupon's strategy and just buy the knockoff company? Brian's gut instinct was to say no. Integrating Wimdu's finance-centric and metric-driven team could harm Airbnb's design-driven culture. he was also reluctant to reward what he saw as a legal extortion racket rather than a sincere attempt to create value in the market. Yet Brian felt he had an obligation to consider the offer. Mason had told him that despite the many problems the City Deal acquisition had brought, it had also accelerated Groupon's progress.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.